All right, so we'll just go ahead and get started. This is Travel is Free podcast thingy, episode 2. I guess once you have 2, you can officially say it's a podcast. And I'm here with Stefan from Rapid Travel Chai. And Stefan is one of the most well-traveled people I know and has the goal of going to every country in the world. So I will go ahead and start by asking you, what's your country count at, though? Maybe you don't have an exact up-to-date number because you do like 12 a week, but you've been a lot of places.
I think it's UN 131 and Traveler Century Club, just short of 200. I think I'm 197.
Okay. And, I never really have a good explanation for the Travel Century Club country count. I mean, the UN, everyone knows countries based on that definition, but the Travel Century Club, it's almost by region, but you can't really say that either. But
yeah, it's like all things, it's people like to argue about it, and this is one club that has their own list. There's even broader clubs that have lists that go into the 600s, into the thousands. Do you start visiting every state in the world, in every country? Do you visit every county in the U.S.? People make their own things. I like the Traveler Century Club list. It's, I think, currently 324, and for the most part, it includes the U.N. countries plus distinctly governed territories. So Bermuda is part of the U.K., but you can hardly say you've been to England if you've been to Bermuda, and vice versa. So those are typically the ones that end up fitting in. And then at the margins, people always like to argue about what should be included or not. A recent addition was Margarita Island off the coast of Venezuela, which when I went to Venezuela, I didn't even notice it on the map, and it's not quite clear exactly how distinct it is, but I'll have to get back there at some point.
Yeah, one simple example I give is just like the UK is England and Wales and Scotland and Northern Ireland, and anyone, you know, would likely distinguish, like, to say I've been to Wales and Scotland, or I've been to England and Scotland, but the UN doesn't do that. They just say that's the UK, and so the Travel Century Club divides that up a little bit differently. Do you know anyone who has been to all the Travel Century Club countries?
I don't know the exact count. There's a couple dozen, mostly retired. Depends. Sometimes they're grandfathered in, depending on what was a country or was not. One of the last hurdles to get is Antarctica is a number of unique destinations, and you can hit one on the coast and then the rest reaching the center. And a number from the club went last December, I think, to the tune of about $80,000 a piece to fly down and stand in the center on a cube of ice, and that probably I won't ever be doing. I could think of a lot better uses if I had the money. But so some people, their thing is all the inhabited territories, so not going to the center of Antarctica, not going to Bouvet Island in the Atlantic, but going to all the inhabited ones.
Sure.
And for me, that's a lot of the fun, is discovering new places that I hadn't even noticed before that turn out to be incredibly fun. An example I like to give is Prince Edward Island, Canada, is actually on the list, along with the French territory of Saint-Pierre-et-Miquelon, Canada. And Prince Edward Island turned out to be one of my wife's favorite travel destinations for its seafood and beautiful scenery, and that's how we came across the place.
Yeah, and I should say that you're one of the most well-traveled people according to that list, and also you kind of you just see a lot of each country too, I would say. At least that's my observation. You know, a lot of people argue about like traveling fast or traveling slow. Obviously you're fast, Rapid Travel Chai, and I feel like we both prove like the stereotypes wrong. Like, so a lot of people think people who have traveled fast just stick their foot in the airport and leave, and they don't actually get to see all the places. And I can spend like a month in a place that you spent one day, and you'll have seen more of it than me. So, like, I couldn't believe how much you saw in Egypt in a short amount of time. And I'm going to go to Egypt and I'll probably see, like, three cities. And, you know, so there's not, you know, there's not a set way. Although,
And I don't bother worrying about other people's travel or their critiques. The slow travel aficionados usually critique from their perch on some expat backpacker hostel with their banana pancakes, and they spend half the day sitting there on their iPhones. So I don't really worry about how they're experiencing it. If that's what they enjoy and how they want to visit, it's perfectly fine. I have limited time, a full-time job, and I really like to put together itineraries where I see a ton of things, and if that means driving through the night to be somewhere by dawn. In the case of Egypt, I landed about 3 in the morning coming in from the States. A friend had helped me find a driver, and we drove through the night to reach Mount Sinai just before the St. Catherine's Monastery closed for the day, climbed the peak, and by sunset we were off and heading up to Port Said on the northern coast of Egypt.
Yeah, and like I said, so that you definitely prove the slow traveler is wrong, and you know, like I said, I can stay in one spot for a long time, and if I enjoy a city, I don't really care, you know. But that's the funny thing is that so many people in the travel hobby, they tell you what you did wrong, and that is just, it's got to be the most annoying thing. That seems like if it's a travel conference, 50% of the people there will know exactly what you did wrong with your itinerary. And, you know.
That along with the, you must do this, and this is the best of in the world, and all that. A lot of that gets very annoying. And my overall concept is when I visit a place, I want to leave having no regrets or something that I absolutely feel I have to go back to see. So if that means spending 10 days in Iran, which I did, you know, that's the time I commit to it. But Lebanon, when I visited in January, I spent 24 packed hours, and that's the time I had. It's a beautiful country. You could spend a lot more, but I saw what I really had to see and made the best of it that way. And that's my feeling, is I try to see generally two distinct places. If it's a capital city, go see a UNESCO site or a nature site out in the country, see some small towns, as well as the major city, some combination of that to get a feel for a place in as little time as I have and just maximize my experience and learning.
Yeah, and your Instagram seems to show that you do a lot of that. It's hard to keep track of you, but...
Sometimes I space things out a few days.
I know you do that.
To not have it cascade.
But every once in a while, you know, Carrie and I are sitting there, and she's like, "Do you know where Stefan is right now?" I'm like, "No, I'm pretty sure he was just in France." And then, like, the next day you're in Guam, and that really does happen. But and then also, I knew you were in New York when you did your last Instagram. And so she said, "Do you know where he is now?" And I was like, "He's in New York. Don't worry." But
had my nieces in town for a visit, so I was a domestic tourist.
Yeah, I read that.
Sites.
I guess there's so much I could ask you. I would say, I mean, besides being well traveled, you're one of the most well versed in the credit card sign up thing, and everyone enjoyed your frequent traveler speech thing on credit cards. So we can talk about that. We could talk more travel. Actually, you know what? The funniest thing that Carrie and I talk about all the time is that you remember we went out to some place in Chinatown, and you'd just gotten back from Prague, and you came up with a list of things that make a tourist destination, or things so you know to avoid them. I don't know how we kept you going, but unfortunately it went off to a different subject, but it was pretty darn funny. But one of them was mojito bars.
Yeah,
you know,
they've swept across Eastern Europe along with the British budget carrier airlines, and
Yeah. So and then wax museums. I wrote that down. So
I heard a good one from Richard Reed, the former Lonely Planet travel writer, about the U.S., which is when the fudge shop sets up in town.
Oh, that's
the that's the ultimate for the U.S. Of mega tourist trap. And I did see Branson, Missouri, over Memorial Day, and there was a centerpiece fudge shop.
Yeah, and okay, so I was going to ask you about China and the Great Wall, because that is a great example, because we went to Badaling, but also we just got back from Riga and Tallinn. Have you been?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not kidding you. I'm in the center of Riga, and one of the restaurants in the center of Old Town had a pirate. I mean, the waiter was a pirate. You know, everyone's dressed like some kind of like medieval times looking.
Yeah.
Like these stupid restaurants, and they're all the crazy thing.
And it's probably serving sushi too,
or pizza, you know.
Yeah.
But the crazy thing is that these places were filled, and it's like someone goes to Riga or Tallinn, and they don't want to eat the local food; they want to eat from a pirate. That's the thing. For me, you know, I don't care what other people do, although, and you know, we were just saying that, I really don't care what other people do, but I do kind of feel like the wax museums, or especially the pirates, kind of take away from the culture that I want to go see. You know, I want to go see how the local people live and what the local people eat, and instead I have a pirate following me around trying to hand me a track, you know?
I think Italian, they do eat the sushi. But
well, that's
not
true.
The pizza, but no, I think it's a great example, and I do encourage people to go outside whatever bubble they have. I mean, Italian's an example. There's not a lot in Estonia that jumps out for a tourist as must-see. Much of the country has gorgeous forests and natural parks that are great for families to kick back and relax, but not as many of the must-see. You know, they've got the old town and that, but not a lot that's absolutely must-see. When I went there, I drove out in the morning trying to get to Poldaski, which is an old Soviet nuclear sub-base.
Hmm.
And it turned out there's very little left of the base. There's some ruins, but much of it has been converted into a free trade zone port. That's fenced off by companies and container ships. So there was interesting, some bunkers and different places left. But just by going out on the road as I was driving back, I saw a sign written in the local language, but I could translate Holocausti. That was easy enough, and a Star of David. And so I turned off, and it was a deserted, small concentration camp called Kluge Concentration Camp, which is a spectacular, very sad, of course, memorial that I spent the morning walking through. And at the very end, it turned out one of the suburban trains from Tallinn has a stop right at the back of the memorial that anyone doesn't need to take a taxi or rent a car, could just take the train. It's not more than 20 kilometers outside town, a short commuter train ride, and you could have a very poignant historical experience as part of their visit there. And that was one just by driving down the road that I happened to come across.
Yeah, and I mean, it's awesome when you can accidentally find those places, but you seem to, I mean, the whole thing of Rapid Travel Chai, to some degree, is that you plan a lot in a small amount of time, but how do you find these places that are a little more obscure? I mean, if you Google things to do in blank, you will get 10 lists that are all exactly the same, and it's like, you know, you go see the church, you go walk in the main square, which has the church.
And you see the three men on the bunch with the hats, and the bench with the hats in front of the church.
Yeah, exactly. And
I'm done with colonial old squares in South America. I've certainly seen my fill of them, and I don't like when I hear a lot of kind of perpetual travelers, travel bloggers that say, I don't look at the guidebooks, I don't do anything, I just show up and ask the locals. And I think that's an important part, but that that works when you have an open-ended time frame that you can spend 3 days getting your feet on the ground. And, yeah, but when you did it, you went to Venice and asked the first person you saw in the airport, and she got great tip-offs. You didn't hang at a hostel for 3 days before finishing your beers and heading out. So, talking to the locals is important, but I really like to plan a lot, get a sense of where I want to go. I'll typically get a guidebook like A Lonely Planet in advance and just go cover to cover, essentially, through the book, what things stand out as really special, different for that place. You know, there's so many that have great beaches, but if you're not going for a beach holiday, you don't need to see everybody's beach. You don't need to see every cathedral in Europe. That's something we talked about, Estonia, this former nuclear sub base from the Soviet Union. That was something that you're probably not going to get on the southern coast of France. So I picked that out as something that was very distinctive, and from there, by happenstance, found even more interesting places along the way.
Yeah, and to another great example of Lonely Planet doing a good job, and I guess, well, I'll say that the part of the reason I think they do a good job is they include everything. So they'll tell you all the touristy spots, but they'll also tell you some of the more obscure spots. That seems to be my perception. But I actually asked Darius, because, he's a foodie. So I asked him, how would I get some tips on good restaurants? Normally, I just ask the most local-looking person that exists. Mm-hmm. But he said that sometimes Lonely Planet, while they do have touristy restaurants, they have good ones. And so I did this in, I guess, kind of reverse, because when I was in Zakynthos, Greece, the guy we stayed with had the best restaurant, I think, in the world. Mm. It was called Milanos. And I looked it up on TripAdvisor, and it didn't even have reviews. I mean, it had reviews, but it wasn't on the first page. And that's because all of his customers were locals. And, a lot of these people don't even give a darn about the internet. So they're not going to be going to TripAdvisor in masses. And everyone who's using TripAdvisor in Zakynthos is going to be a tourist. But anyways,
that's the thing, is that the TripAdvisor dilemma is that I think it can be useful for finding accommodations at times that might not be listed on major search engines, tourist sites. It can give you some up-to-date info. The restaurants, it's what other tourists are telling other tourists, and
right.
And a lot of places. Yeah, and it can be helpful, and certain requirements you might have, dietary requirements, may be good. The Lonely Planet dining recommendations, they often do well at telling you the one restaurant that's been there since 1950 and has a great historical theme,
yeah.
And you can have a quality old-fashioned meal. It's if you want the more up-to-date, pretty much every country has some local version of a Yelp or a local magazine. They may not all be in English or that accessible. There may be some expat kind of themed magazines, even a Time Out magazine. It may be written by expats in a country, but it's much more local and up-to-date of what people living there are actually doing. And that can be great for what's going on and what to do.
Yeah, and actually what I was going to say is that I took his recommendation, went to Lonely Planet, and it was the first restaurant. It had a little star. It was the only one that had a star next to it. And said, this is the local hotspot. It's the place you must go. And so, it had a few other restaurants, but this one had some kind of special, this is the one we picked kind of thing. But anyway, so I just thought that was to your point, that just because it's in a guidebook doesn't mean it's touristy. And in fact, if you just Google the top 10 things to do, it's guaranteed to be copied and pasted from the top 10 TripAdvisor things. So, so this kind of brings to China, and I'll tell you, similar to my pirate story in Riga, we went to the Great Wall, and we went to Badaling because it was the easiest to do by public transit. And, at first, have you been?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I lived in Beijing for several years.
Yeah, I knew that, yeah. But
Every time somebody from our company came to visit, somebody had to take them to the Great Wall in Forbidden City. So yeah, we parceled out who had the short straw every time.
And did you go to Battling more than once, or did you boycott that?
I think I've only ever been there once.
Okay, well, yeah. So anyways, when we got to the end, you know, there's a megaphone playing. You can, because we did a, it turns out you can do a full circle. And because lucky us, because we just kept going, we thought we were going to have to do the whole thing. But so anyways, then the, you get to the end and there's a roller coaster. There's a panda. There's a loudspeaker. Then there's like a yak. They're not panda. They're bears. They're feeding like, I guess they're like brown bears. And then it just like keeps getting more and more absurd until it's like a really, really bizarre theme park. And that is, that was just the most puzzling, bizarre thing I think I've ever seen. It was just, I just can't believe that they decide, you know, tourists like bears or whatever. And it just doesn't occur to them that, or whoever's in charge of putting the circus there, it didn't occur to them that people want to go to feel like they're in the middle of nowhere or they're in a piece of history, that they have to have a roller coaster.
That doesn't bring in the extra cash. But yeah, it's true. The kind of carnival atmosphere they put in some of those sites is really frustrating. And if you're relying on public transport, you've got Badaling, you've got Mutianyu, which has a little bit of that. You can sled down the mountain, but it's a little more relaxed and sedate compared to Badaling.
Yeah, but
I guess you could say it's to the Chinese, it's not a holy place. It's a site to go have fun. So a lot of the gimmicks there are targeted for domestic tourists too, who are looking at the novelty and are maybe a little more comfortable with bizarre juxtapositions thrown together and
shrugging. Do you think they actually enjoy that?
Yeah, I think some. I mean, it's Great Wall, Beijing is kind of the thing that every Chinese wants to visit in their life. So more than any other place of China, you see tourists who, you know, it's the first time they're getting on an escalator. So you see them really nervous stepping back, because they've truly come from a very rural background. And then you also get the most sophisticated urbanites going there. So I think for some, it is just fun. And, you know, it's like, what do you do with your kids on a trip too? And so some of that gets added in. It's incredibly tacky, but you mentioned Prague, and for all Prague's plaudits, and I thought a lot of it was incredibly tacky and very wax museum.
Yeah, and that seems to be what people want, I guess, because it exists and people go to those places.
Yeah, I mean, around Beijing, there's some great hikes along the wall that are much less touristy or have segments. Most have been developed to a certain degree. One of the classic hikes is from Jinshanling to Simatai, and there's no effective public transport. You're going to hire a car, so you're looking at around $100 to $150 US for the day to have that car. And connecting between the two is about a 4 to 5 hour hike, depending on your fitness. And in parts, it's very rugged, very steep. It's not restored in every part, so the rocks crumble. I took my father on it a few years ago. We made it through, and even some of the enterprising local villagers come and help guide people up and down the steps for tips to help on some of the steeper sections. And on both sides, there's a little bit of amusement park, but in the middle, you've got the wild wall to yourself and an excellent experience.
Yeah, even the Badaling, it was really steep. I was surprised, at least, how...
How many women are in high heels and doing it, too?
I mean, just in masses. And this is the same place that has a roller coaster, so you think they would have, like, better handrails with the steep part or something.
You don't have quite the same safety precautions in China, so at the steeper mountains, there's lots of those... hey, look at me, last pictures that happen, unfortunately.
Yeah, well, I was a little, I'm scared of heights, so I was a little paranoid going down myself. But anyways, so, well, let me ask you about, we can go credit cards or like favorite places. I guess we've already done a lot of places, and I always feel obligated to do something miles and points related.
Yeah, sure. That's the gateway to doing a lot of this on a tight budget. It's fascinating too.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, you, like I said, your credit card talk was amazing, but I know you earned some miles from business travel, but how much are you earning from credit cards, or what percentage, and yeah, how much of your miles earning does that take or bring in? Yeah,
business travel is probably half and half, and the real value of the business travel to me is using it as a springboard. You know?
Right.
My company, like many, will allow you at your own cost to take additional time off when you're at a destination, provided the return airfare is no more expensive. So that springboard can be really useful to save an extra day of travel and get my work done and then go have some fun. I like the credit cards a lot compared to a lot of the other more time-intensive activities. Some of the manufactured spend, some of the things like Amazon reselling are incredibly time-consuming. They can be very lucrative in terms of miles and points, maybe not in terms of a full-time occupation, but they require actually being essentially at home in the U.S., moving and shipping product in and out, going to stores constantly. So I think that unless you have a significant amount of time, it's very hard to scale and get that payback, whereas credit cards are something that you have a busy lifestyle. You can essentially look at it every 90 days, every 180 days, add a few credit cards, meet the spend, and have a stash of points to fund the next round of travel, and in the interim not need to be on the 24/7 chasing every deal, the next $10 off $100 at Kmart gift cards that you can resell here and do this, flip that there. And also there's less risk in the sense that you get a new credit card if you know how to manage your credit, which is the most important thing about credit cards, and if you can't manage your credit successfully, you should not consider opening new cards. But if you can do that piece, a lot of the risks that happen with manufactured spend, you know, mailing tens of thousands of dollars of gift cards to your mailbox and going to stores and loading up cards or walking around with money orders, a lot of this actually is pretty risky if you stop and think about. I've known people that have, one guy got robbed right out of a CVS and lost a couple grand and had to shrug it off. But a lot of these methods, it takes over your life, and I don't want them to take over my life. I want tools that allow me to do the travel I want to do, which a lot of places in the world, you get beyond the main destinations, are extremely expensive to pay in cash. You want to get to Micronesia. Essentially, you got to fly United, and those tickets are very, very expensive. But often, on an award ticket on United, they can be quite reasonable and abundantly available.
Right. Yeah. And yeah, I agree. And I'm probably away from home as much as you, more than you. I at least am in the. Yeah, I would say I don't have a home, you know, but I'm in the U.S.
You're king of the quick hit and big score, though, what you're doing one day.
Yeah, I mean, but it's still tough. I mean, I don't do a lot of the things. Like, I'm not going to bother to go through, like, a portal twice. And it's not because it isn't lucrative. It's just because it's too much setup. But also, you know, like, we went to, I think it was Colombia or something. We meant to liquidate a bunch of gift cards. And we didn't. So I don't remember how many thousands of dollars of gift cards we had, and we're just like hopping around Central America and Latin America at that point, it's not even paranoia. I just kind of like, you know, I know where they're stashed. They're like in the bottom of this zipper. But yeah, it's definitely a lot of risk, and I definitely didn't check that bag, needless to say. But you know, sometimes you know, that could have really gone wrong, because I have, recently I got on a flight and they made me check on, it was this Baltic Air, and they just...
Oh yeah, they police the carry-ons pretty tightly.
Oh man, and they did not let me get our what we normally carry on. They did not let me carry them on, and then they got to charge us for the check bag. Anyway, so how often are you doing, or how many credit cards are you applying for, and how often are you doing it? I remember you had like a spreadsheet of which ones you applied for and whatnot. I don't remember the time frame, but it looked like you were doing maybe 3 or 4 in one day.
I typically follow the idea of the 90 days, which is not necessarily scientific, but the difference between a recent inquiry on your credit report and a non-recent is 90 days. So for a number of issuers, it seems to be a reasonable time frame to get approved. Barclays is tougher, that maybe every 6 months or even more to get that. But I'll try to collect what interests me of offers and do it around 90 days. I think this time I've been busy with family and travel. Let it slip a month until I can have a few hours in the morning to go through it. But I do try to do a bunch at a time, and I'd rather do a dozen at once and wait 6 months than keep spreading them out and as much as possible bundle the credit inquiries, same banks, same day, hoping that they'll merge and get ones approved all together, deal with it all at once, and then maybe let my credit report rest for a while.
And have you done a dozen at once? I know.
Yeah, I've done a dozen.
Okay. Wow, that's impressive.
I think at least once, and that one, I think I got 10 or 11 of them approved.
In your name or both you and your wife?
No, just myself.
Oh, okay, that's impressive. I'm trying to... I've gone over 90 days right now just because I'm trying to play nice. I think I maybe got a little greedy with some of the last offers, but so the next one, I wrote it down. I should have had it available, but the next one I'll probably go for the Alaska cards, and...
They're great. You've written wonderful posts on the use of Alaska Miles. I keep trying to put together a Pacific trip where you can redeem Alaska for Fiji Airways for incredible prices. From what I've heard, they don't generally operate their flights when you're expecting them to, but they're the only game in town for Christmas Island and Kiribati and a bunch of other places. So you gotta go for it at some point.
We flew them once. And it was probably the most hilarious flight I ever saw, because they did the food service. It was like, this is from Auckland, by the way, so it's like a 4-hour flight. It's like 30,000 feet. They were up and they were serving all the food, and it wasn't long after everyone got their food that they all gathered. It was a half empty flight, and I think it was a 747 too. So. It might have been going on to LA, but it just felt really empty. And then all the flight attendants sat in one area together, and they just sat there. For the rest of the flight, they did not go back around, see if you need water. For the rest of the flight, they sat and they were telling jokes or something, because they were laughing. I mean, everyone on the plane knew where the flight attendants were, but anyways, they just kind of sat and had fun. And it was just kind of, and actually at the Intercontinental Fiji, they have gardens. We were there on point breaks a few years ago, and so we booked 8 nights for like 40,000 points, something like that. And our room, you could see, you have your own garden, but like through the garden leaves, I could see behind one building, and I could see all the cleaning ladies hiding from the managers. So every day I could see them like hiding, and then one of them would like, you know, like be out doing something, and then like say something, and they all spread, and then a manager comes over. Anyways, I loved Fiji, but I could. Anyways, that was just a rant from their timing.
Some of those you just have to enjoy the experience. You can either get a dumpy U.S. airline or an uptight Asian airline, and then sometimes in between you get these just bizarrely quirky ones that at the time aren't all that fun in retrospect. I mean, like Sriwijaya in Indonesia that I flew to East Timor, it was I've never seen a more relentless sales pitch. And they had one guy hawking,
really?
One flight attendant, he was selling scarves, and another was doing perfume, and just seeing this man modeling these female scarves and trying to get the women by it, it was like visiting an old market in town.
Now this was the airline's like commissioned products, or was this guy like bringing on his mom's?
No, they were the flight attendants. Yeah, so they're commissioned products. And
really?
It was nonstop. It was like a. Just a parade of salesmanship.
Well, maybe they put their flight attendants on commission.
They must, yeah.
But and you also said in East Indonesia they can be quite not so good with getting on time flights or.
The whole country, yeah. I mean, you have just very unpredictable weather. You have. Many runways that have incredibly challenging approaches, and you have airlines that are totally shameless in their operations. Lion Air in particular, I've just had nothing but cancellations or major delays. And fortunately, my last flights with them last year, they had the courtesy to cancel it 3 days before departure. So at least I could try to find another airline in time.
Wow.
But I mean, one of the ways to see Indonesia, not all that convenient, is to use something like Air Asia, even if you have to connect back through Malaysia or elsewhere to get around. That won't cover the whole country, but it can be much much more reliable to go in and out of Indonesia from foreign carriers than purely domestic.
Yeah, I've hopped around, at least from Bali to Yogyakarta or Yogyakarta. I don't know how to say it, but anyways, and then on, so we stayed there for a little bit and then went on to Singapore, and I've always had good luck with them, and I think I got the flight from Bali to Yogyakarta for like $10 too, so and then onward I think for like another $15-$20 to Singapore, and that was a decently long flight, and you know, so that's a free stopover right there, because just booking a ticket separately for $10 each.
And if you are looking at booking a lot of the Indonesian airlines, a lot of them are not bookable on many of the global search engines and OTAs. So there is a local website, and ticket tiket.in, or I forget the .id, I think is the country abbreviation. But that's a local travel agency that can book all of them. And in that cancellation I mentioned last year, it took like 10 phone calls because they kept hanging up on me and not wanting to deal with me. But I did finally find someone to get me on a new flight and give me a refund of the old one and get it processed. So,
wow.
That's one of the better options for booking those domestic Indonesian carriers.
Yeah. Well, I'm all for an East Indonesia trip, but we'll get that sometime. But do you have an example of what your next application is going to be like?
So it'll probably be next week. As I said, I've been busy, so put things off a little bit. You mentioned Alaska, probably doing that. U.S. Bank, I've frozen my IDA ARS a few months ago. Those are alternate credit bureaus that U.S. Bank frequently uses. So I'll do some new applications for them, probably the FlexPerks Amex, and maybe another Club Carlson card. Chase, I've got a nice collection, and I don't do much with them. Amex, a little bit undecided. They have a hard rule of 4 open credit cards that excludes the charge cards, but the 4 credit cards, I've all got cards in the slot that I don't necessarily want to drop. I think the Capital One Venture, I've been looking at that. I had heard various reports that the Venture 40,000 offer, some people have done 2 applications at once and gotten them both approved.
Oh, wow.
So I think I'll give that a try. The City Premier, I have City Prestige and a whole bunch of City Thank Yous. I think I'll add the Premier and then do another Premier about 8 days later. There's a few oddball ones that I've always wanted to apply for the heck of it and never done, but every so often I may throw in something like a La Quinta or wherever, even though I've never stayed at one, just to, to do something different. But that's not that's not very rational. Or
yeah. You know, one thing I don't see I haven't seen talked about in hotel cards is the Fairmont card. I guess maybe it doesn't have affiliate commission, but
that's true as far as I know. But we just booked my wife's two nights for her stay coming up in Boston. She went last year. The first time she got the card, she got the card again this year. So that's a rare case where I convinced her to also get a card. But the Fairmont card, you get two nights at truly spectacular hotels around the world. Our last ones we used in Montreux, Switzerland, the home of the famous jazz festival, and it's an old palace, and it truly is a palace. So it's a chain of very individual historic properties. So every one is very special. Banff in Canada is one that I've long wanted to go, and hoping to use my two nights for that. The card is not great for much else. It has its own rewards program separate from anything you would do as a Fairmont member on actual stays.
Yeah, you earn points, but as far as I know, there's no Fairmont points. So what is that?
Yeah, it's points you can redeem for Fairmont stays at just absurdly high prices. And then there's a few things. I think the card has a minimum spend of $3,000. And that's good enough for a $25 Starbucks gift card if you never put another dollar on the card. But I forget the award chart it has, but it's only points that can be earned through the credit card or spend on the card.
Right.
And unless you're staying at Fairmont's, there's not many category bonuses. So the smart people that have done the math said it doesn't really make sense. What can make sense is if you keep the card and you spend $12,000 in the year, it's not calendar year, it's your card member anniversary year, you'll get a free night good anywhere in the world at their hotels. And that's very competitive compared to some of the other premium hotel cards that have similar spend requirements and a similar bonus, but often with more restrictions.
And you get that on the annual fee, right? So when you pay the annual fee, you get the free night, similar to the Hilton Reserve card, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's nice.
And it's not restricted to certain days of the week. It's not restricted to certain hotels. There are hotels that have blackout dates, but they're not that onerous. Boston, we looked, part of early August is blocked out, but the last half of August is not. It's that kind of thing. It's very selective. So you can pretty much use however you want, with a little bit of advanced booking.
The only problem with that is ending up with 12,000 Fairmont points, that I guess it's $100 of Starbucks coffee, am I right?
Yeah, I was meaning to look. I think there's some in between that are good for upgrades or different things or dining.
Yeah,
it can make it a little better. If you're planning to keep the card long term and you keep doing that 12, I think the room awards start somewhere around 50,000 to 70,000 points. So after a few years, you would end up with another night is maybe the way to look at it.
Okay.
The funny thing is, the part of the benefit of the card is when you sign up is supposed to be these breakfast certificates to go with your free nights, but they're actually capped at $25 each.
Yeah.
You stay in Switzerland and the continental breakfast is like $38 and that doesn't even include the fruit table, and then you realize you're not, one person eats breakfast for one day out of what was intended to be four breakfasts.
Right. And there probably aren't too many cheap Fairmont properties.
No, I think Seattle, I'm going to Seattle tomorrow for business, I was surprised to see that rate come up and as reasonably competitive. I don't know what the hotel's like, and yeah, I think there's a handful of exceptions. For the most part, you're looking at some very high end hotels. I think the Boston one we looked at, and all of the dates we looked at, they were 500 and up, and we figured out why there wasn't a suite upgrade available when the suites go for $5,000. So.
Right. Yeah. And you know what I learned, though? I learned this via Twitter. They actually, somehow they responded to something. I might have just asked them. Anyways, that the Fairmont free nights does not work at the properties, partners with Fairmont or under the Fairmont chain. It's just the Fairmont brand. So you can't do it at the Raffles or the Swiss Hotel. Is that the other partner?
I think that's correct, yeah.
So it's just Fairmont properties. So, for example, they have a nice property in Seychelles that's under Raffles or something like that.
Oh, okay.
And that would not be available under the Fairmont card, free nights.
That's too bad. And I think it's Plaza New York and Savoy London where I think you can't use the upgrades. Is that right?
I don't know, but...
Yeah, there's some distinction of that. But for the most part, it... there's a few quirks. I tried booking the one in Hamburg at one point.
Okay.
And for two of us. And there was something that it's such an old hotel, most of the rooms are too small. So they were telling me that all the rooms are single occupancy. And Fairmont's actually has very good customer service, and they were trying to fix it. But I don't know if it's since been rectified, but it was just a weird thing where they could book me in the room, but everything was saying it had to be just one person.
And this must have been like the phone number that handles the free nights or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just not code,
and
right?
And so they got us in Switzerland, and we had a great time. But it was just, yeah, I mean, there's some quirky old properties. So it's okay. Possible.
Huh. Well, anyways, I went 3 minutes over my time cap. That I said I would try to keep it under 45 minutes, but for other listening people's sake. But I really appreciate you taking the time, as always. To chat with me, and I hope everyone enjoyed listening. And just reminder that your website is rapidtravelchai.boardingarea.com. You don't have rapidtravelchai.com, do you, or do you?
I do. Yeah.
Oh, you
do?
Okay.
It works. Yeah.
I'm surprised I haven't tried. I'm too lazy to type out anything full, but luckily Google Chrome just lets me hit RA and then autofills. But anyways, thanks for coming on, and I'll probably see you sometime soon.
Great. Thanks for chatting.
I'll talk to you soon, anyways, and thanks for listening, everyone. See you, Stefan.